Please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
So I would think that the market should take on board some more rate hikes, and that's what I think the Nifty Bank is clearly indicating. 0.6 down now on the Nifty Bank. The bigger indices, Sensex Nifty, are down about a third of a percent, quarter percent if you please. But I would still think that today the Bank Nifty weakness would be important. Today they won't have too much of support from IT either, because of the way the rupee has surged. I mean, a rupee surge is actually unhealthy for the economy, even if it bolsters a foreign investor's confidence that his money will not erode. For an economy, it cannot be good news. You normally see the Nikkei falling when the yen rises. At the moment, the metal stocks are the ones that are taking it on the chin. So Manisha got it bang on. It's Hindalco, Vedanta, Tata Steel that are the top three losers in the top five. Grasim also is there for good measure. Because of the cross-holding, perhaps. And then you have Bajaj Auto also giving up a little. Of course, it had run up after its numbers. ICICI Bank is the next in list. In fact, ICICI, SBI, both of them losing ground now. Tata Motors, the domestic performance is not cheering enough. And Maruti Suzuki continuing in its weakness. Then you have Yes Bank, Axis Bank. So actually, the banking pack is now reacting belatedly to perhaps the feeling that policy doesn't have all good for it. Then okay, let me look at the positives also. Because of the fall in global commodity prices, HPBP, IOC are your top gainers, the top three. There's also ONGC, which is a little inexplicable. Then there is Indiabulls Housing that is up 1.5. I think numbers are due today. And then you have Lupin, Coal India, Power Grid, Bharti, Infratel, Sun Pharma. So I think Pharma is kind of doing reasonably well today. The tech stocks are not falling yet. HCL Tech, TCS are still in the green. But they will have a complaint or two with the way rupee has risen.
Okay, well, not a good opening for the mid-caps either, Lata. The market breadth has opened in favor of declines this morning. More than 627 stocks on the declining side. The index itself is down 0.3%. And the space that's getting hit the hardest, two spaces actually, metals that you spoke about as well, and PSU banks, PNB, Bank of India, Bank of Baroda, that whole lot. As we were saying yesterday also, that bonhomie, little bit of bonhomie that we had in the PSU banks, that's actually come off quite a bit in the last 2 days. So keep an eye out on these stocks. Apart from that, Apollo Tyres is falling some more post its numbers, down about 1% over there. Ashok Leyland, Tata Motors are stocks that are in the red right now. BEL is coming in for some profit taking. In fact, Pidilite as well, you know, in result reactions. Pidilite is, I think, down about 0.7%. So good, decent numbers, but perhaps profit-taking coming in to that name. On the upside, few and far between, actually. HEG is looking very good post a stellar set of numbers. So HEG is up in the green. It has these other graphite companies, in the gainers list as well. So Graphite India is up about 3% or so, I think. Just pull up that stock. Okay, 2% higher now. Avenue Supermarts has hit another new high today. So that's been moving up. And XL Cropcare, that merger news flow has come through. The board has approved the merger of XL into Sumitomo Chemicals. So XL Cropcare is up almost about 2% or so. Gateway Distripark, Tata Elxsi are also in the news this morning. So that's the list of gainers. But otherwise, it's really a losing market that you have on your hands. Down about 0.3% on the index now. And your top loser, the metal names Vedanta and Aisha Motors after weak numbers.
Okay. Well, that's the opening for you. Sudarshan, you had been positive about Vedant, but now all the metal stocks are coming for a drubbing for because of global reasons. Anything you want to say on the metals?
Yes, I think it's better to exit the stocks. We were trying to find a low or a bottom, and clearly that is not visible. So there is no need to stay back in metals. Just close that trade if you have any metal stocks. In fact, I have short ideas now on Tata Steel and Tata Motors. Oh. So metals is no longer a buy. Okay. But the Nifty is not a buy yet also. This is not a buy on dips opportunity. Stay away.
Okay. Is there any level at which it will be a buy, Sudarshan? What is the trade now?
Well, the trade was to buy around 11,300. But given the open, I think we have to shift that level down to 11,280. Right. We don't buy till it reaches 280.
Okay. And Ashwini, your first trade now, have you taken any on the Nifty?
Mild pullback on Bank Nifty. I think that's where the selling should accentuate. That's where the rally was. I think it's a good trade to get short on Bank Nifty and expect, you know, 300-350 point down day on the Bank Nifty, particularly because, you know, it's had a rally and people are long on Bank Nifty and Nifty a lot.
Okay, by the way, we're not alone in this fall. If you look at the Asian markets, Anisha very helpfully points out that the Hong Kong index is now down more than 600 points. So we should just pull that market up for you. As we were telling you, the US-China trade concerns have resumed. Look at that, almost a 700-point slash down in the Hong Kong market. This is because there's, you know, this possibility of Trump hiking the proposed tariffs on
Chinese
goods.
It is directly on them. Yeah, so obviously, Hong Kong will react much more than Indian indices. But, you know, when metals fall, when there are these kinds of macro trends, we can't really stay out.
Stay away.
Yes, we get impacted a little less because we were not in the global supply chains. Mitesh, any trades you have observed now? The cuts are getting deeper, 0.3% on the big indices, Sensex and Nifty, and 0.2% on the Nifty Bank. Mitesh?
Yeah, Lata, I think, you know, a couple of stocks which come to my mind. One, iShares is breaking the recent swing low of around 26,980. In fact, we might get a gap breakdown today. So iShares is on the sell list for the time being. A couple of pharma names look good. Sun Pharma, we had a buy call in the morning. I think Lupin is now joining the party. I think intraday signals are turning quite positive. While ONGC also continues, that was a buy call yesterday as well. But even today, I would be comfortable buying with yesterday's high as the stop loss.
And, so today's negative sectors are, as you said, PSU Metal. Bank, metals, and even auto for its own reasons.
Absolutely. iShares, Tata Motors, Maruti, M&M, that whole lot is actually down 1.5%. Ashwini, what's the big call for the day?
The big call is that, you know, metals are going to have a really serious downside. And, you know, while the Nifty is trying to hang around this 11,300, I think on rallies, people should take short positions on Bank Nifty as well as Nifty, because this is not a domestic issue which gets resolved and where support levels, etc., hold on. If this keeps getting worse, you know, this Hang Seng and all of this trade war and tightness of, you know, global market, chances are we will break 11,300 at some point.
All right. Gentlemen, thank you very much for staying on with us through pre-market and the early market hours and giving us your trading strategies. We will touch base with you at 10 a.m. Well, markets have found their feet 0.3% below yesterday's levels. So 11,300 has held for the kind of big rally we saw over the last 3-4 days. This is only a minor scalping, not very huge. Only the Nifty Bank has taken off 2/3, but then the rally was also more pronounced over there. With this backdrop, let's invite our market master for the day, Harsha Upadhyay, CIO or equities at Kotak Mutual Fund. Good morning, Harsha. Thanks much for joining us. Something that would have been only a 1 hour event or a half hour event for the markets, the monetary policy. Did you take away anything from it? Did you see future tightness and therefore trim positions on NBFC or some of the realty or consumer companies? Any interest rate sensitive move post policy?
Good morning, Lata. As far as the monetary policy was concerned, I think it was more or less on the expected lines for us. We were expecting either a pause or a hike, and we have seen that hike. And from here on, I think in the short term, we don't expect interest rates to move much. Yes, as far as the stock positions are concerned, we were anyways running underweight on some of the interest rate sensitive sectors such as real estate, maybe even NBFCs to a large extent, and various other interest rate sensitive sectors. So from a portfolio perspective, we have not really made changes after the MPC decision. Mm. Definitely, I think as we move forward, if there are going to be interest rate hikes, it will be more of data dependent and we'll have to watch that out.
Okay, so no changes to your portfolio post the monetary policy decision yesterday. Harsha, hi, good morning. The one interesting trend we've noticed this month is that the leaders of the auto rally, the likes of Maruti, iShares, etc., have now started to slow down in terms of growth. You know, Maruti hardly grew this month. iShares, in fact, has reported the slowest Royal Enfield sales in the last 11 months. You think the time has come to churn out of these stocks or it's just a minor blip?
See, you have to be cautious on auto sector for a couple of reasons. One, I think for the last 7 calendar years, the sector has outperformed the index. And when you see such a strong cycle, You should always be careful about the continuation of that, and hence you need to be watchful of valuations. And as far as the volume growth in the immediate context is concerned, it may not be right way to look at just July numbers, because it's not a trend, and also you had GST transition happening last year same time, which would have altered the base in some sense. So possibly you should look at maybe 3 months or 2 months of last year around the same time, and year on year basis how we have grown this year. If you look at that, volumes are still continue to grow at a reasonably healthy pace. But what is disappointing in the auto sector today is the earnings numbers have been much below expectations across the board, and that indicates a clear margin pressure in the auto sector. So with the kind of valuations we have on some of the auto companies, not all of them, definitely it's a matter of concern. So one needs to be cautious on auto sector.
Point taken. I mean, I remember Sonia's disappointment at the Bajaj Auto numbers.
Yeah.
I mean, the earnings were quite at variance with what the monthly sales performance had led us to believe. But Harsha, then parse for us the other earnings in the season so far. If autos were a spot of bother for you, what impressed you in the earnings season?
Lada, it was more of similar lines in case of IT and retail private sector banks, where more or less almost all of the companies delivered in line or slightly better than expectation kind of results. On the corporate focused banks, the slippages seem to have peaked, unless something else comes out of the mid-market or the SME basket. But the normalization of credit costs would take some time. Maybe in financial year 20, we'll start seeing some normalization of credit costs. As far as consumer staples and discretionary were concerned, broadly they were okay except for auto. The margins have been very, very strong. The volume growth continues to be across the board in double digits for most of these segments. So that was kind of a heartening point to note. As far as capital goods is concerned, it was more of a mixed bag. We didn't find any clear trend in terms of earnings season. So these were a couple of the points, and the big disappointment was obviously the auto sector, where the earnings have not been as much as what the market expected.
So what is your own earnings estimate for the full year for FY19 and FY20? What kind of growth are we looking at, and have you changed it at all after this quarter's numbers?
I'll stick to FY19 as of now, because I think FY20 is a little bit of a guesstimate at this point of time. And if you look at FY19, the consensus estimates for Nifty earnings is around 600 rupees. Whereas internally, we believe that achieving that would be very, very difficult, given the fact that 50% of incremental growth between 19 and 18 was supposed to come from corporate banks and other banking and financial names. Whereas the retail banking and financials would deliver a steady amount of earnings growth, we were unsure of how corporate-faced private banks as well as PSUs would fare. And that has come true even in the few of the results that we have seen in the first quarter. So to that extent, and also the fact that there have been some disappointments in other sectors, we think somewhere around 550 rupees is what we can expect for financial year 19. And even based on that, the markets are quite elevated in terms of valuations.
Okay, so markets are elevated in terms of valuations. Getting back to individual stocks and sectors, wanted your thoughts on how to approach the entire PSU banking space now. I know we briefly touched upon it, but Bank of Baroda, after reporting a loan growth of 20% after so many years, has given rise to some hopes that the NPA cycle is, the worst of the NPA cycle is coming to an end and loan growth is starting to pick up. Would you put any money in PSU banks, or is this a space that you would still stay away from?
We are largely underweight on PSU banks, and we will remain with that positioning for some more time until we get clear sense of what's going to happen on the mid-market and the SME space there. I think most of the recognition has happened on the large corporate loans. I think the slippages have also peaked there. And slowly you will see credit costs normalizing going forward. But whereas in case of mid-market and SME, we really need to see how that's going to pan out over the next few quarters. And that's what will decide whether we will increase or we'll remain at current levels of PSU banking exposure.
Okay, so still underweight on the PSU banking space and need to see a few more quarters of convincing, you know, numbers before taking a call. Final question then, Harsha. By the way, just one word on the market. The mid-caps actually are playing for a bit of a recovery right now, so do keep an eye out on that. Names like Dilip Buildcon, Hexaware, HEG, Imami, these are stocks that are, look at the mid-cap index, it's now moved up to the high point, and all of these names that I suggested, Hexaware, Dilip Buildcon, HEG, etc., are doing pretty well at the moment. But Harsha, so, you know, just to talk a little bit more about your expectations, you said 550 rupees is the EPS that you're expecting for the next year, the Sensex EPS. What kind of returns do you see for this market? I mean, we've already seen about 8% or so from the index this year. Over the next 12 to 18 months, what are you forecasting?
Sonia, purely based on fundamentals and the earnings growth that we are penciling in, it will be very difficult to expect a large returns, large amount of returns from markets at this point of time. We believe that the next few quarters will be a kind of a consolidation phase. The mid and small cap basket has fallen much more than large cap basket for the last two or three quarters. Maybe we will see some consolidation happening and some bottoming out happening over the next two, three quarters. We really don't expect large returns to come by in the next few quarters. I think whoever is putting in money, and anyways, everyone should be doing that. One should be focusing more on 3 to 5 years at least in equity investments rather than looking at how a calendar year or few quarters are going to pan out. Our view is between now and elections would be the great time to accumulate stocks and maybe wait for another 3 years to get really good returns on that.
Okay, how much cash are you therefore sitting on cash rather than deploy at these levels?
No, Lata. As a corporate policy, we really don't maintain too much of cash. We are always within the limits of 7.5% at every stage, and currently we would be on an average about 4 or 5%.
Okay, all right. Okay, the other question I want to ask you is, how have flows been for the month of July? We did see a bit of a dip in June.
Flows have moderated quite a bit compared to the beginning of the year levels. Clearly there has been a large amount of redemptions which have taken away much of the sheen from the equity flows. But the SIP numbers and the EPFO investments still continue. So to that extent, you have healthy numbers on a net basis, but quite moderated as compared to, let's say, Jan or February levels.
Right. Okay. We'll leave it at that, Harsha. It's always a pleasure having you with us. Thank you for joining in today. Well, while we thank our market master, just want to point out that the pain is getting big for the big indices. It's almost 0.5% gone on the Nifty, and it's about 0.75% on the Bank Nifty that appeared to recover to 0.5%, but it has gone back. And to put it in perspective, yes, it's also the global scenario, which is way bleaker. And while we may not be affected by the Chinese goods getting into huge tariff problems, the fall in metal prices and such other global issues, like even tightening of global markets, if the Fed were to go with rate hikes. After all, their commentary was very strong. They said the economy is on a strong footing. They noted that the labor market is also improving fairly strongly. So these all point to a future tightness of money, and maybe the markets are reacting to all that. Look at the way Asia has fallen. Any index you pick is down between 1.25% and 1.5%. So that's 2.5% on the Shanghai and the Hang Seng. We've got away with a minor bruise, you will have to say, in the context. We'll take a break on that note and we will come back to discuss earnings again. We have the big bright one, HEG, lined up for you. Ravi Jhunjhunwala, Chairman and Managing Director, joins us.